welcome back for some more insignificant events in the life of a cactus. This is Mrs. D, and we finally had some nice weather, so I thought I would sit outside today and record while I read, because heaven knows we've needed a beautiful day. All right, we're on chapter 17. So, like, I know you don't go to therapy anymore and all that, but my mom and I were browsing online, and we found out there's this social event for kids with Tourette's over at the hospital, I said, walking next to Connor on our way to class the following week. Connor stopped and turned to face me. You mean a support group? Well, sort of, I said. I don't need a support group. I'm totally fine. I just thought it would be cool to meet some other kids who have the same things as you. You know, maybe even make some new friends. Actually, it had mostly been Mom's idea, but she thought it would be best if I brought it up, so Connor would be more open to it. Connor raised an eyebrow at me. I don't know. It would be just as much fun for me as for you, I said. It turns out I like kids who have Tourette's, and I don't have all that many friends. So I'd like to go and see about making some new friends. In a place where I'm not the only kid who's sort of different. Connor continued giving me his skeptical look. Really? Well, I looked up support groups for kids with no arms, and guess what? There are none. At least not that I could find. I guess Tourette's is a lot more common. 1%, said Connor, as he turned and continued walking toward class. What? 1% of people have Tourette's. See, I blurted. I bet lots of kids with Tourette's go to this social event. Support group. Whatever. It might be fine. Please, will you go with me? Please, I begged. Are you saying you'd go without me? He asked. Why not? Because you don't have Tourette's. Well, I could just meow from time to time. No one would know. Connor gave me a playful shove. Fine, I'll go with you. He rolled his eyes. And you won't have to meow. Mom walked us into the hospital just after 7:30. A receptionist directed us down a corridor and into a small meeting room. Mom promised to pick us up in front of the hospital at 9 o'clock sharp and left us there to brave the meeting alone. As we entered the room, we were immediately greeted by a boy shouting, "Chicken nipple!" I looked at him in surprise, and he shouted it again, aiming it at no one in particular. I glanced at the other kids in the room, 5 boys and only 1 other girl. "What's with all the boys?" I whispered in Connor's ear. Tourette's is way more common for boys. Connor barked as we stood there surveying the room. The other kids didn't seem at all fazed by his barking, but they watched me with curiosity. That was okay. A pretty woman walked into the room and introduced herself to us. "I'm Andrea," she said, shaking Connor's hand. "Are you Connor?" Connor nodded, barked, shrugged, blinked his eyes. He was nervous. I could tell. "And you're Avon, Connor's friend?" Andrea said. "Nice to meet you," I said. "Why don't you two find a place to sit and we'll get started." I could see Andrea also had Tourette's by the way she made a funny counting motion with her fingers, but other than that, she seemed to keep it under control. I wondered if she had a milder form of Tourette's or if she had learned how to control it. If so, I wanted to find out for Connor. Chicken Nipple Boy moved over a seat so Connor and I could sit next to each other. He yelled out, "Chicken Nipple!" as I sat down next to him, and then he leaned over and whispered to me, "Do you have Tourette's?" I shook my head, "No." "Oh, Chicken Nipple, I do, in case you Chicken Nipple didn't notice." I grinned at him. I wasn't really sure. "I'm Dexter," he said, "Chicken Nipple." "I'm Avon." "Well," Andrea said, sitting down in the circle, "I guess we can get started. Everyone, we have a couple of new friends with us tonight." She turned to us. "Why don't you guys introduce yourselves?" Connor was ticking so badly, so I spoke. "I'm Avon." "Avon doesn't have Tourette's," Andrea said. "Yeah," I laughed. "Can you imagine? What a doozy that would be." Dexter laughed out loud and shouted, "Chicken nipple!" And the other kid softly chuckled a bit. I liked Dexter already. "At least if you had Tourette's," the completely monotone, expressionless girl sitting across from me said, "you wouldn't have to worry about slapping yourself in the face all the time like I do." As though on cue, the girl slapped herself in the face. "Yeah, But you should see what Avon can do with her feet, Connor said, blinking his eyes rapidly. Face slapping isn't that far-fetched. I want to chicken nipple, see what you can do with your feet, Dexter said. Maybe later if we have time and Avon doesn't mind, Andrea said, smiling. She clearly enjoyed the lighthearted conversation among us kids, and honestly, so did I. Andrea turned her attention to Connor. Introduce yourself, Connor. I'm Connor. I do have Tourette's, as if you couldn't tell, he barked. Well, welcome you two, Andrea said. We're so happy to have you. Why don't we all go around and introduce ourselves? We'll start with you, Dexter. Chicken nipple. I'm Dexter. And as you can see, I love to say chicken nipple, chicken nipple. Connor gaped at Dexter. I have to know, why chicken nipple? Why not another word? Dexter has a rarer form of Tourette's called coprolalia, Andrea explained. He says words and phrases, some of which people may find inappropriate, but he can't help it. Connor turned his attention back to Dexter. Yeah, but why chicken nipple? Dexter laughed. Sometimes I say other chicken nipple things. I'm glad when it's just chicken nipple. Sometimes I say barbecue or pirate ship or I love bubble baths. And some chicken nipple other things. Sometimes I say my own name, which is really embarrassing for some reason. One time I went through a short period, chicken nipple, when I said, I'll punch a baby, every time I saw a baby. That was awful. Chicken nipple. People would run away from me with their chicken nipple babies. Dexter looked at me with a straight face. Chicken nipple. I swear I would never punch a baby. I like babies. I believe you, I said, trying to maintain a straight face myself. Just then, Dexter cried out, barbecue chicken sandwiches! And everyone laughed, especially Dexter. I normally would never in a million years laugh at someone's disability, but I realized we were all laughing with Dexter, certainly not at him. And it was okay. I think it made everyone feel better in a way. Josh introduced himself next. Josh made the same whooping sound all the time and had what Andrea explained were several motor tics. This included bending over a lot and sort of like playing air guitar. Other than that, Josh was quiet. The girl introduced herself as Rebecca. I already knew Rebecca slapped herself in the face. She even wore little padded gloves to help soften the blows. I had never realized Tourette's could be painful, even damaging to the person who had it. Rebecca also grunted and coughed a lot, even though she didn't have a cold or anything. Jack rolled his eyes constantly and shook his head. He also made a strange yelling sound like nothing I had ever heard. Like he sucked air in so fast that it made a shrieking sound. Zachary rolled his shoulders so much he feared he would need surgery on his already worn down 15-year-old joints. Mason made constant farting noises with his mouth and pulled on his hair, which made his hair patchy because he pulled on it so much that some of it would come out at times. Mason had over 50 tics, he told us. I couldn't imagine having to deal with that many uncontrollable things going on in my body. Besides Dexter, Mason's tics were probably the most embarrassing of the group. He already hardly ever went out in public, like Connor. Andrea guided us into a discussion on how we felt about going out in public, more specifically, going places like the movies, the library, etc. Connor wasn't alone in not liking to go to the movies. No one ever really went. Rebecca was the only one who felt okay going to most places because her vocal tics weren't as loud as the others, and she could almost sound normal at times if you assumed she had a bad cough or something. People still got annoyed with her frequently, though. As cool as Dexter was, he was terrified of going out in public. I guess he said, I'll punch a baby in front of some dad holding a baby in the drugstore one day, and the dad nearly attacked him. Had Dexter's mom not intervened, it could have been bad. Once again, I thought if he had been wearing a t-shirt explaining he had Tourette's, maybe the situation could have been avoided. Dexter also had obsessive-compulsive disorder, which Andrea explained often accompanied Tourette's. It was hard for him to leave the house because he worried so much that the stove and oven were on at home. He even asked if he could call his mom a couple of times during the meeting so he could have her check on them. It sounded as though most everyone's parents were supportive and understanding of their Tourette's. Well, everyone except Connor's parents. Some of their extended family members, such as aunts, uncles, and grandparents, often accused them of faking it for attention, like Connor's dad did. I thought it would be exhausting to put on such an act all the time. I couldn't fathom why anyone would want to do such a thing, or how anyone could think they were doing it. It was strange listening to everyone speak among a cacophony of barking, farting, whooping, shrieking, and chicken nipple. It was also strangely comforting. No one cared about my lack of arms. They were all far too caught up in their own struggles. And I, for once, felt completely normal among this group of misfits. I hoped Connor felt the same way and would come back with me again. So, how was the meeting? Mom asked as she drove us home. It was great. I looked at Connor for confirmation. Yeah, Connor said, it was really good. He looked out the window. That's great. What did you guys talk about? All kinds of stuff, I said, like what everyone's tics were and how they felt about going out in public and things like that. I could see Mom watching Connor in the rearview mirror. Do you think it was helpful, Connor? He said absentmindedly. I asked if you thought it was helpful, Mom said again. Connor shrugged. I guess so. Yeah, it was nice to meet other kids like me. What? I asked when Connor trailed off. I'm worried I'll start swearing like Dexter. I don't really think of chicken nipple as a swear word, I said. You know what I mean. You heard Andrea, I said. That's pretty rare. Yeah, but Dexter started out like me too, making strange noises and movements. And then one day he said chicken nipple and everything changed. I guess I'm afraid the same thing will happen to me. I couldn't see Connor's face as he gazed out his window. Things are hard enough the way they are. I can't imagine how hard it would be if I started saying obnoxious things all the time. I think I'd rather have brain surgery at that point. You shouldn't worry about it, I said. I think the more you worry about it and stress yourself out, the worse your tics will be. And maybe if you start saying words, it will just be normal stuff, like, I love African safaris, or something like that. Connor chuckled. That's normal? Yes, for someone who loves African safaris. I don't think you should think about it too much. When's the next meeting? Mom asked, obviously trying to change the subject. Next month, I said. They meet once a month. We should go back because we're going to talk about relaxation and how it can help when we're out in public. You mean when we're out in public, Connor said. You don't have to worry about that stuff, Avon. Maybe not that kind of stuff. I may not have tics, but I still have to deal with people staring at me and treating me like I'm different. Yeah, but you don't call attention to yourself. I think I'd give up my arms to get rid of my Tourette's. Don't say that, I said. I like you just the way you are. Really? Connor gave me a skeptical look. Yep, tics and all. All right, so I really like how supportive Avon is of Connor and how badly she wants to help him. I'm trying to figure out Avon's motivation for going to the support group for kids with Tourette syndrome because she doesn't have Tourette's. I'm wondering to myself, is it really because she wants to help Connor? Or do you think that she has a need to get support for herself so that she can feel more comfortable in new situations in public? Or maybe is it a combination of the both? We obviously meet a new set of characters this time around, and while they laugh with the whole chicken nipple thing, and they kind of got a giggle out of the barbecue chicken sandwich thing, it was different than when they were in school. These kids laugh together and not at each other. And I really liked the idea that Avon said that if the kids wore a shirt that said, I have Tourette's, then maybe people wouldn't make fun of them. Let's think about that for a minute. Isn't it kind of sad in the world that people would need to wear a shirt to explain their condition and so people won't make fun of them? I think when people understand what's going on in someone's life, they're a lot more understanding of that person and not likely to make fun of them. But it's kind of sad that we have to really put a label on something before we're kind to others. I don't know, this book makes me think about how when I'm in public and I see somebody who might be acting differently or looking differently, instead of worrying about what their condition is, just being kind to them for the sake of being kind. Kind of an interesting thought. All right, we're going to go ahead and read chapter 18. By late fall, the weather was finally starting to cool down to a comfortable temperature. I had read every single tarantula book from the Desert Ridge Middle School Library, the Phoenix Library, and the box we'd found in the storage shed. I now knew terrifying things about tarantulas, like that a type of wasp called a tarantula hawk would sting and paralyze a tarantula, then lay its eggs on it and seal the tarantula up in a burrow. Once the wasp grub hatched, it would feed on the tarantula meat. Gack! I couldn't wait to use that information to shock someone. I even blogged about it. I had written several more posts on my blog, mostly stuff about the park, school, tarantulas, and how I do things without arms. Pretty random stuff. So I called my blog Avon's Random Thoughts. Anyway, it wasn't about anything terribly exciting, but I had gained a few more followers. Zion now commented pretty regularly on my posts, and Emily still made her usual LOL and I miss you remarks from time to time, though I hadn't seen any comments from my other friends in Kansas for at least a week. Dad and I practiced soccer in the arena together early on weekend mornings when it was cool outside. It was wonderful to feel a chill in the air again. But every weekend I felt less and less enthusiastic about getting out of bed to get out there. I think Dad must have noticed my waning interest. He found an old tuba somewhere at the park, and he came into my room one morning, played horrible screeching sounds on the tuba, then announced, "All hail Avon Laura Green, future queen of the Desert Ridge Middle School soccer team." I smothered my face with a pillow and told him there was no such thing as a queen in soccer. The next weekend, he played the tuba and announced, "All hail Avon Laura Green, future emperor of the Desert Ridge Middle School soccer team." And the weekend after that, "All hail Avon Laura Green, future world dictator of this Desert Ridge Middle School soccer team." Dad said the snakes would be hibernating now, so after we practiced soccer, I would hike up the hill behind Stagecoach Pass. I liked being able to look down on the park and the rest of the city, and I liked visiting my giant saguaro. I spent most of the time on the hill looking for tarantulas and collecting quartz rocks. I had quite the collection going on at home. I wore a loose, open bag around my neck so I could easily drop the rocks in with my toes. Most of the kids at school were now ignoring me completely. I guess they were used to seeing me around by now, so I wasn't getting any more shocked looks. It was more like I just didn't exist. I sat next to my giant saguaro a while, looking down at poor old Billy and Fred, endlessly hauling kids around the dirt trail. I thought it might be time for them to retire to the petting zoo. I wondered if we could replace them with a little train, like the one I'd seen in a mall. Now that the weather was cooling down, business had picked up a bit, but my parents told me it was barely enough to keep the park running and cover all the repairs that were building up. I stood and walked around to the backside of the hill, hoping to find some new rocks. A strand of something dark caught my eye. I slipped my foot out of my flat, grabbed it with my toes, and tried to pick it up. It was connected to something in the ground and wouldn't come loose. I put my flat back on and started kicking at the dirt, trying to unearth whatever was under there. Eventually, I loosened enough dirt to get the strand free. I laid it out on the ground and studied it. It was caked with dirt, but I could tell it had once been a necklace with a polished turquoise stone set into a dark metal. I lifted it with my toes and slipped it into my bag. I rushed home to call Connor and tell him what I'd found. After all, we'd seen that necklace before. Where could they have seen that necklace? That sounds like a clue to me, piling on to the other mysteries of the Stagecoach Pass amusement park. All right, that's all for today for Insignificant Events in the Life of a Cactus. I hope you enjoyed it. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye.